Oh, it's the, you're showing the sanctuary. Oh, there we go. Good morning, friends. Welcome to Sunday morning worship here at UPC. I am in Geneva Hall, and it is happening in here. Good morning. Hello. Look, you're on TV. Anyway, so welcome. We have a guest preacher here today, Dr. Mark Labberton, who has an incredibly long, rich history here at UPC. And so we will get to hear him preach today, and it is a, it's just such an encouraging call and reminder for us of the work that God has done here at UPC and what he is continuing to do right now and what he's got for us planned into the future. And so I am so excited to hear it again. And if you didn't get to hear Reverend Nicole Massey Martin last week, she is got some incredible sermons too for us to unpack. And so look, if you have the time, do go back and listen to that. Pastor George has set us up good as he and Ann are on their sabbatical over in Cambridge. And so anyway, at any time, if you would like prayer, hit that blue prayer request button and we will pray with you in a private chat room. And you'll hear some announcements from Pastor Ken Sanu, but on Tuesday night, we've got an update from our auditors and our treasurer on Zoom. And we also have a session here at Geneva from a really good personal testimony about a woman who has unpacked her own history and has learned things about that. And so anyway, with that, let's quiet our hearts. We're not going to get quiet in here, but let's quiet our hearts and join our friends in the sanctuary and prepare our hearts for worship.
Welcome to UPC this morning. Whatever our week had, I want to invite you to come and bring yourself to the Lord. whatever sorrows, fears, music, joys were in your week. It's good to be together and to praise God together. So if you're willing and able, we invite you to stand, sing this great Charles Wesley hymn with us, "Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing." Please remain standing and join me in this prayer of confession from the Book of Common Prayer. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. And Almighty God, through the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, we have assurance that you will have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins, and strengthen us in all goodness. By the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen and hallelujah. Let's continue singing our assurance of pardon with "On Christ the Solid Rock I Stand." Just the voices. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Amen.
the former president, and so I'm so grateful to hear from him this morning. Hey, if you are new, we would love to know that you're here. So in front of the pew pocket in front of you, there's what we call a connect card. We would love for you to fill that out. Let us know you're here. And maybe you're not new, and you have a prayer request, or you want to get involved in some kind of way, please fill that out. And in the silver box out in the lobby, you can turn that in, and somebody will reach out to you as soon as possible to get you connected into the life of our church. And again, a special welcome to our college and young adults. Don't forget that immediately after this service, across from 47th Street in the Palmer House, we have a delicious and free breakfast for all college and young adults. So I hope you join us then. So now, I want to take a minute for everyone to get to know each other, to meet one another. And so let me just set it up this way. I know that the last week has been a little dark and it's been a bit rainy, if you will. Share with somebody, as you say hello, what your favorite rainy day activity is. All right, go.
Are we switching? Favorite rainy day activity? Ooh, I like to read and I like to knit. How about you? Lee, Simone, Marta, Jason? I see you guys. If you don't have an activity, maybe you have like a favorite warm beverage that you like in the mornings. A coffee, a tea. Are you a tea drinker, a coffee drinker? Just jump in there and let us know. And with that, we're going to go back into the sanctuary and join the worship team and sing the doxology.
Praise God from
In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, good morning. My name is Ken Sanu. I serve as Pastor of Outreach here at UPC. And at this time, I would like to extend an invitation to all of our young disciples, our elementary kids, and our middle school students. You are invited to go meet your teachers in the back. We absolutely love having you here with us. You are such a blessing, and we hope you have a great time with your teachers in your class, all right? And as they leave, I'm going to invite Linda Quist and Dee Dee Kiersey to come forward. I'll give you that. And Linda and Dee Dee were part of a team this past summer that went to Bosnia. And so can you share with us, why did you go to Bosnia?
Well, first, I'm Dee Dee Kiersley. This is Linda Quist, and Jim and Paula Westfall came with us this summer to Bosnia, and which is part of the former Yugoslavia, representing the Balkan Task Force of UPC. There we go. The purpose of our trip was to touch bases with people we have met before in Bosnia. We went to help by encouraging them, spiritually, emotionally, psychologically, and financially. There's the camp. We prayed with them and showed them how God has helped us and how God can help them too.
That's great. And can you share one specific story where you saw the impact of God in that area?
Mm-hmm. Yes, I will. The soil of people's hearts is hardened in Bosnia with bitterness and suffering from the war in the 1990s. One story is about Fisnik and Manjola, missionaries from Albania in Bosnia. They came to the Lord in Albania after the fall of communism as college students. After serving as missionaries in Kosovo, they were called to Konjic, Bosnia, and have served 11 years in Konjic, but few converts. They are now fluent in the Bosnian language and have many friends in the community. The team brought craft activities for a children's group and later had a special opportunity to share coffee with Manjola. And with tears, Manjola shared that they were called to serve in Bosnia and that they love the people and the community. They know that they are called to be faithful and that the harvest is up to the Lord. This decision over the years was not without material sacrifice and hardship. Manjola and our team were able to pray for each other and encourage each other. Over the years, UPC teams have provided craft activities for children and women in Konjic in support of their outreach. In addition, the summer camp, which we participated in Mostar, provides an opportunity for refreshment and encouragement for believers and missionaries.
Wow, thank you. So what are some specific ways that we can be praying for this area and ways we can get more involved?
Please pray that the Lord will open up many opportunities for people to know him, and there would be continued reconciliation between ethnic groups and deep healing and in the hurts and betrayals left by the war in the region in the 1990s. Anyone interested, by the way, is welcome to join us, the Balkan Task Force. We continue to meet, raise funds, pray for, and learn about the region. Contact Ken, and he will get you in touch with me.
That sounds great. Well, let's say a prayer right now. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the efforts of so many people who have been working for reconciliation in Bosnia, in that area. And we pray especially for our mission partners there, those that are working so hard to try to share your good news of grace and forgiveness and salvation. We know, Lord, that the work can be slow and hard, and we ask that you would send signs of encouragement to these mission partners. Thank you, Lord, for the team that went, and bless us as we continue to look for ways to engage with our partners in Bosnia. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you very much. Well, as we get ready to offer our tithes and offerings to God this morning, we remember that our offerings support mission and ministry of this church and all around the world. We remain committed to our mission partners serving in places like Bosnia, and we have many other mission partners in many other countries. Giving here at UPC, supporting the church's mission, we've made it as easy as possible. I find the easiest way is to just go online, upc.org/give, and that is the way that it's an easy way for anyone to give your offerings. Or if you brought your offering this morning, we do have boxes in the lobby and outside of the balcony that you can just drop it in those boxes following the service. So let's pray God's blessing on our offering, and then we'll also go into our prayers of the people. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we bring our offerings to you and ask that you use these gifts to accomplish your purposes, to build your kingdom here at UPC, in Seattle, and all around the world. We give as an act of dedication to you. And Heavenly Father, we thank you for blessing us with new mercies every day. We thank you for your faithful presence. Help us to present our bodies as a living sacrifice to you, so that we're not squeezed by this world, but that we can be transformed to do your will, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Grant us the strength to not only change our behavior, but also our attitude, and show us how to act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. God, we want to emulate Jesus. We want to love as Jesus loved, to serve as Jesus served, and to be salt and light in the world through what we say and do. Everywhere we look these days, it seems that we have reminders of human suffering. We are absolutely overwhelmed by the amount of pain in the world. We grieve for the continuing war in Ukraine, as well as the war in Gaza. And we hold two things at once. First, we continue to be horrified by the heinous attack by Hamas on October 7th. We pray for the safety and quick release of the hostages they are holding. And we grieve and lament over the worsening and horrifying humanitarian situation in Gaza. Widespread hunger, lack of clean water and medical supplies, and so many civilian casualties. Lord, we turn to you once again in a plea for mercy. We ask that you hold those close to you who are experiencing unimaginable grief. You protect those working to provide relief for the wounded and suffering. You guide hearts and minds everywhere towards peace. God, we thank you for our mission partners in Bosnia and for the church's work of reconciliation in that region. We lift up to you those who are facing challenges and pray for your intervention and healing. We especially remember Janet Labberton, who recently broke her arm. We pray, Lord, for strength and healing there. We pray for those in our church family with memory issues, that they will always remember how much God loves them, that they would experience his peace and presence in the midst of the confusion and frustration they may be feeling. We pray, too, for those caring for loved ones with memory issues, for patience and compassion and strength during times of exhaustion and worry. We pray for those who are lonely, isolated, and afraid, that they might know God's loving kindness and faithfulness and find community and fellowship. And we lift up to you those in our UPC family who are experiencing health issues. We pray for baby Malcolm as he heals from eye surgery, for God's presence and strength for Malcolm's parents, Irvin and Anna. We pray for Elle, who has an injured leg muscle and is in constant pain. Pray for relief and patience. We lift up to you Laurel, who has had serious health issues for the past couple of years, for continued healing and full restoration of health. We pray for Barry, Dale, Jean, Marion, and others who are recovering from surgery or illness. Lord, draw us closer to Jesus. Keep us faithful in ministry as we seek to share his love and grace. We lift our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we consider our tithes and offerings, I wonder this morning if anyone this week has had moments of feeling downcast of soul, or if anyone even right now is feeling downcast of soul. I want to say, we're glad you're here. That's why we need church, to be reminded, as this psalm, Psalm 43, that we're going to sing, reminds us to place our hope in God. He is our salvation. So please stand, if you're willing and able, to sing Psalm 43 with us.
Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against the deceitful man, O deliverer. For you are the God in whom I take refuge. Why have you rejected me? I walk around confused. Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Bring me to your holy hill, to your dwelling. Then I will go of God, to God my exceeding joy. Then I will praise Him with my guitar, oh my joy, my joy, oh my joy.
Let's sing that verse again. Vindicate me.
Vindicate me, oh God, and defend your light. Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Bring me to your holy hill, to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God my exceeding joy. Praise Him with all my heart, oh my joy,
my joy.
Down, Lord, oh my soul, why are you cast down, Lord, and in turmoil? Hope in God, for I shall again praise Him. Hope in God.
Sing that again. Send out your light.
Send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Bring me to your holy hill, to your dwelling. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God. exceeding joy. Then I will praise him with all my heart, oh my joy, my joy. Oh my joy, my joy.
Amen. Please be seated.
Amen. Thank you. Well, we are so pleased this morning to welcome back to UPC the Reverend Dr. Mark Labberton. Mark grew up in Yakima. He attended Whitman College, and that's the place where he embraced Christianity. He then went on to earn his Master's of Divinity at Fuller Theological Seminary, and then earned his PhD in theology from the University of Cambridge. Now, Mark is no stranger to UPC. He served twice on UPC's staff. He received a sense of call to ministry at UPC. He was supported by UPC in seminary, and he was ordained here at UPC in 1982. Starting in 1993, he served for 16 years as senior pastor of the First Presbyterian Church of Berkeley. In 2009, he joined Fuller Seminary as professor of preaching and director of the Lloyd John Ogilvie Institute of Preaching. And from 2013 to 2022, he served as Fuller Seminary's fifth president, and now he is president emeritus of Fuller Seminary. But on a personal note, I want to share that I've known Mark since I was in college. I was a college student at Cal, and he was the college pastor at First Pres Berkeley. And so I have fond memories of every Sunday going to church in the morning, and we would meet with a group of college students, and it was a group called FOCUS, Fellowship of College and University Students, and Mark would lead us in that time. And then after that time, we as a group would then go to the sanctuary and hear Earl Palmer preach and worship there together. So is it any wonder that I ended up in ministry? I don't know. So let's give a warm welcome back to Mark Labberton.
It's really, 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 really a great gift to me to be able to be here this morning. I just want to start by saying thanks to Ken for his wonderful hospitality and our many, many years of friendship, and for the privilege and gift that it is to be here, because I'm just, I'll admit it, having sort of a moment here. Just be with me for just a second here. So I'm just having this moment where I had not yet graduated from Whitman, and I was attending a summer service here, and that led to a summer internship, and that led to eventually coming back and serving here for 2 years with Marta Bennett leading the inn. So it was my very first worship experiences and preaching experiences to be in the context of actually being here on these very steps, talking to a sanctuary full of college students at 10 o'clock on Tuesday nights. And it was also during that period of time that I received my own sense of call, that God had not just called me to that particular job at that particular time, but to a longer work of both personal transformation and a longer work of ministry. It was because of some people that I knew in this community during that time who asked searching questions, one of which was, what is the question that you most wish people would ask you, but that they hardly ever do? And this question haunted me for a while, and I came back to the friend who said it and said, you know, what I most wish people would ask me is, what is the center of your passion? And the reason I want people to ask that is that I want an opportunity to be able to express the passion that was growing in me in a very, very significant way during those years in my own love and desire to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. It was also here that I met my wife. Actually, I didn't meet her directly first. I met her through counseling two of her former boyfriends who had been part of the life of this church. Eventually, when I'm at First Pres Berkeley, in that nepotistic relationship that exists between UPC and First Pres Berkeley, then suddenly on the first Sunday, Janet is there, and we make that connection, and 18 months later are married, becoming the fourth generation in her family to meet and marry at that church. In this context, it was here really that there was an opportunity to exercise gifts of ministry that I couldn't have imagined. There were people that had already been people that I knew, but people particularly like Steve and Cheryl Hayner, for those of you who remember them, or Tim and Carrie Dearborn, who are still here in Seattle, both such significant parts of my life, parts of UPC's life for so many years. In fact, just yesterday I called Cheryl, who now lives in Madison, Wisconsin, and just had this wonderful, like, nostalgic moment of thinking back when I lived in a house that they had left that had five guys that were living in it, and that we dubbed it the Hainer Home for Unwed Men. It was really a nostalgic thing for that reason. And most profoundly, I want to say simply to this church and for you as the legacy participants in the life of this church, thank you. Thank you, this church, for decades and decades and decades has been a church that has made such an imprint on young lives. I was absolutely early in my life as a Christian. I was early in my development and sense of call. I was early in my understanding of what it meant to actually be a serious disciple. And it was really in all of those contexts that UPC, again and again and again, was so formative. It was really so significant, and it has been true for countless people who have been part of the life of this church, sometimes for long seasons and sometimes for short ones. When I eventually became the pastor of First Press Berkeley, there first as a college student, it was here that I was ordained, as Ken mentioned, because this was the place that had formed me. And then I said thank you, and I want to say now, that many years later, thank you again for the legacy of what you put into my life. It's just impossible to overstate it. I couldn't share the story of my life without naming UPC and the lives of people here that changed me. I know the church in many ways is in what the church, capital C, is in one of its darkest periods. When the church in America may be in one of its worst seasons, when the challenges of what it means to actually even be an authentic disciple, let alone to live in community, let alone live in communities of diversity, let alone live in authentic communities that actually enact the gospel in the world, that is a tall order, and especially so right now, and yet desperately hungry for that. May this church continue to be a church that grows deeper in these ways and demonstrates that reality to the people, seasonal or long-term, who are part of this congregation. Thank you. We're going to read a text that's very well known to many of you, I'm sure, perhaps not all. It's a text that comes at a really important point in Paul's letter to the Roman Christians. He wants them to understand something. In the first 11 chapters, he's been trying to paint that portrait. He's given a very vivid exposition of from reality to reality, from the reality of creation to the reality of new creation. And throughout the book of Romans, these are his great themes. In chapters 1 through 8, culminating in 8, Paul makes it so clear that the God that we worship is a God who, in chapter 8, we're told multiple times, is a God who groans for the full working out of the purposes of God in the world. Creation groans, Romans 8 says. God the Father groans, the Son groans, the Spirit groans, the church groans. Creation itself groans for the fulfillment of what it is that God has intended all along for creation and for God's people. And it's in that context that then he goes on in chapters 9 to 11 to talk about God's special relationship with the people Israel. That is a set of three chapters that also then come back now to this new news that he's announced in 1 through 8 to then explore yet again, but what does this mean for Israel? And then at chapter 12, it's as though I think this text should only be printed as a pop-up book, because there should be now, suddenly we turn the page to chapter 12 and what should shoot up as high as the ceiling in this room is simply the word therefore. Because Paul is saying, you know that I've just, all that I've written, all of this that's an exposition of the mercies of God, in light of all of that, there are consequences that I long for you to see worked out in your life. Therefore, let this be the pivot that actually doesn't just lead you to say amen, or I agree, or I believe, but I will live the reality that has been revealed to us. I will enact and play out first, as he does in chapter 12, in the life of the body of Christ, but also as the life of the body of Christ extends out into the world beyond it. Therefore, Paul says, therefore. And he knows that he's going to begin an exposition of some things that are going to be very challenging. And he wants to ground it in two initial affirmations. Listen to those. I appeal to you, or as is sometimes translated, I urge you, or sometimes translated, I beg you. I appeal to you, I urge you, I long for you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. We'll start with these first two verses, which are verses that I hope, if you haven't already memorized, that you will consider memorizing. They are words to carry every day. I beg you, my brothers and sisters. Paul speaks as one among the many, as a prisoner to those who could still be caught and not yet free. If they are set free, as the gospel, chapters 1-8, so magnificently portrays, then now live out the reality of that good news. And he says, therefore, I appeal to you, I urge you, I beg you. Paul is not neutral here. This is not a calm, cool, and collected lecture. This is not just a kind of externalized exoskeleton that he's trying to describe. He's saying, take the whole of your being, which is what he says when he describes, present your whole selves, your bodies. He uses physical language as a way of describing that this is an embodied faith. Present your whole selves, heart, mind, body, strength, soul, every component. Present your whole selves to God as a living sacrifice. Not as one who just simply has exterminated in some kind of way as a martyr, but one who goes on in the process of release and sacrifice and self-giving, living beyond yourself. I beg you, my brothers and sisters, as an act of intelligent worship. He doesn't suggest this is mindlessness. This is cultish. This is just a spiritual takeover. No, he's actually exhorting them to make a decision and to follow it with their whole selves. Let all of you actually make this response, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy, set apart, acceptable, be able to be received by God, holy, acceptable, and perfect for God's purposes. This is an amazing portrait. Now, it's very interesting that in saying it as he does, he's aware that what he's going to go on to describe is this thing called the church. He's going to appeal to them to live in the church. And as he will make himself so plain in just a few verses, it just turns out the church is, it's just sort of a thing, right? The church is never neutral. It's never ever neutral. It's always something. And the question is, what is the something that is the church? And what Paul wants it to be is an aroma of the reality of the love and mercy and justice of God in Jesus Christ. That's the aroma. It just turns out that being in the church doesn't always easily play that way. Maybe you've noticed. It just plays out in other ways. There's a church that I sometimes get a chance to preach in, and it has stacked services, so you kind of move from one part of the building of the church to another part of the building because of the different times of services. And in one of these little passageways, we go through for about 30 seconds a kitchen, a small kitchen. Every church seems to have a kitchen sort of like this, I think. And as I breeze my way through that little kitchen, there's little tags on all the doors, and they all start with phrases like, don't even think. No, don't open. It's not yours. You're not entitled to use this silverware. Those kinds of wonderful, heartwarming things. If you went to the service, hospitality, hospitality, hospitality. But lurking in almost every church is a kitchen that says no. And somehow it's in that vortex that the church struggles over its identity. On the one hand, we could name the things that we intend to be, but living the things that we're called to be is a whole nother thing. Paul, the apostle, the evangelist, the prophet, understands just exactly that tension. So he says, I beg you, first, start from scratch by offering your life as an act of intelligent worship. This doesn't start in neutral space where you're going to give a little bit of God to this and a little bit of that to that. No, you're meant to give, we are meant to give our whole selves to God. And then the text, ever the wise pastor, Paul, understanding that this is not going to be easy business, understanding that in fact there will be pushback. To live a life of authentic worship means that I'm not going to make you my God. I'm not going to make your ideas my God. I'm not going to make your culture my God. I'm not going to make my job my God. I'm not going to make money my God. I'm not going to make my social status my God. I'm getting really clear that there is one God. When I was in Berkeley, we sometimes did a liturgy that would go like this. I would get up and I would say, I'm not God. And with thunderous voices, they would say, you're not God. And I would say to them, you're not God. And they would say, we're not God. And we would go through a litany of all the other things that are not God in order to be clear about who is God and how our worship is meant to be grounded in that reality. But then Paul says, but friends, do not be conformed to this world. I can sometimes imagine Paul whispering that, as close and intimate a phrase as it is, don't be conformed. Don't let the surrounding world, not meaning the reality around us, but meaning the unreality, which is called reality, the reality that is simply a fallen world that's not clarified in its worship, that's not clarified in who God really actually is, that can so easily lead us astray. Do not be conformed to this world. Don't let your life be molded by that reality. Instead, he says, don't be conformed, but be transformed, which is God's central business, creation and recreation, transformation. That is what God is about. Be transformed by the renewing, that is the recreation of our mind. Paul here uses a word for mind that is not like saying brain. Sometimes Presbyterians can feel like brains on sticks. That's kind of a caricature of a lot of Presbyterianism. It just turns out that it's meant to be whole body worship, and it's meant to be whole body recreation. Let your whole perception, which is really what this word mind here means, let your mind, let your brain, but let your whole being, let your whole perception, which is both intellectual and rational, but it's also bodied. It's also about people and places and physical reality and encounters and perceptions of spaces and the people that we're with and the things that we judge good or bad or otherwise. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your whole perception. So if we were to describe what is the problem in the world, well, one way of describing the problem of the world is that sin sets itself in motion in such a way that we are not able to perceive reality clearly. We don't perceive reality truly. We perceive it in evolutionary terms. We become clearly tribal. We become associated with the people who are like us. We gather with the people who are like us. We consider the people that are not like us, not like us, and therefore a problem. And so much of the long history to this very day, moment, place, and world, that is a core crisis. We do not perceive the other. This is why Jesus' teaching, for example, in the Sermon on the Mount is so shocking. When he says, don't just love those who you like or who are your friends or your neighbors. Even Gentiles can do that. Like that, there's nothing special about that. What happens if I call you now to even become people who love your enemies? Where does that possibility come? We follow an enemy-loving God, not a God of the tribe, not a God who votes and thinks and acts like me. In the words of Anne Lamott, if the God that you worship is a God who hates all the same things you do, it's probably not God. So it is. So how does God actually become God to us? By actually the process of being remade. renewed in our perception so that I see through different lenses than the ones that my sociological and economic and racial and gendered background have given me. Instead, I gradually, through the heart and mind of Jesus Christ, come to perceive my neighbor, even those who may be my enemy, as people who are made in the image of God, who are beloved, and who, like me, are desperately hungry for reality in its goodness and mercy and grace and recreation to remake Mark Labberton. Because my perception is wrong. It can be so self-serving. It can be so self-interested. It can be blind to people whose experience of life has just been dramatically different than my own. It can be dull to compassion and mercy in ways that God wants to recreate. A number of years ago, I was in a bicycle accident. It was quite a dramatic, a simple accident, but a dramatic impact. I was just, it pushed my left eye back in my skull an inch and down in my skull an inch, and it was massively bloody and horrible, and it lasted in its process for well over a year. I've always wished that I could say that I was wearing the yellow jersey and coming in on the Champs-Élysées, and it was really just like that pinnacle bike riding moment, but actually, you know, it just turned out to be a bike ride on a Sunday afternoon on a bike path in all too flat Alameda, California, with nobody around. No water, no danger, no cars, no nothing except one bike that happened to stop right in front of me. And as it stopped, I went up on my front tire and their straight handlebar went into my eye. It was in the course of that that then I went through this process of healing. Months and months, it took over a year, and I had months where I was just laying on my bed as flat as I could get with no light and as little sound as possible. And it was a very difficult time. And it was in that time that God, I felt, said to me one day, you know, Mark, I am actually going to restore your sight. And the medical treatment that I got was amazing, and gratefully my sight was restored. But God said, in a way that I felt was clearly the word of God to me that day, Mark, you know, I'm going to restore your sight, but you have a much deeper need than that. What you actually need is not just restored sight, but changed vision. I want you to perceive me and your neighbors and your family and your work in ministry and the people that are your friends and the people that are your foes. I want you to perceive them in the way I do. And that means a change of the heart. That means a change of perception. That means I walk in the world with a different comprehension of what's happening around me. That work necessarily continues to this day. But it was for me a turning point in the application of this text to say, I do, O God, want to perceive the world as you perceive it. And I don't. I perceive it in better ways than I was before I was a Christian. But I have so much further work. And Paul, knowing that the challenge is what it means to be a faithful church in the world, a world that is then, as it is now, racked by injustice and suffering and pain and disappointment and depression and uncertainty and fear and anxiety, in that world, I want you to be my people. I want you to offer your whole selves to me as an act of sacrifice. And then I want you to allow yourself to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That over time, by the work of God through the Bible, by the work of God's Spirit, by the community that you're in, by the deliberate actions that you can take to actually come to see the world through the eyes of others, so that increasingly my perception is now not just the perception of little Mark Labberton, but really a perception that has now been layered by the grace and mercy of God in Christ, but also informed by people whose lives are radically different than mine and whose experiences in the world have been completely different. And now my perception of the world is changed in significant ways by the gift of those new and different perceptions, all because that's what I need, and that's the thing to which Paul calls us. There's a woman in our church in Berkeley who at the time of this story was 85 years old. Her name is Doris. She was an elegant, tall, Presbyterian lady who, in the era of her life, had her hair done every Friday at 11. I wonder if you've known such people. Doris, oh my gosh, she was amazing. And she was gritty. One day in the middle of worship, I get a note passed to me saying that something terrible had happened to Doris. It was unclear, but it sounded like she had been attacked in some way. I was very, very anxious to get word. We couldn't seem to get word. Eventually, just before the service ended, at the last service, I heard that she was now at home. So I immediately made a beeline to her apartment. She had always been my pastor, but I thought finally I could actually be Doris's pastor. So I show up, she invites me in, we sit down. It's clear that she had been flustered. I said, "Doris, what happened? I really don't know anything except that I heard something terrible happen to you." She said, "Well, it was the strangest thing. You know, I was just parking my car. You know that place?" And I said, "Yeah, that place where you park your car." She said, "Yeah, I was just parking my car in that place. And I reached back in across the driver's seat, across the console to get the nut muffins. Remember the nut muffins that I always make? I was just getting the nut muffins when suddenly I got struck from behind and someone pushed me into the car, across the driver's seat, across the console and into the passenger's seat and grabbed the keys out of my hands, put them in the ignition and took off. I'm just breathless." She said, "So I just couldn't figure out what was going on." I said, what's happening? Who are you?" Note to self, I thought, when being kidnapped, ask your kidnapper's name. It was Jesse. I said, she said, "Jesse, what's happening?" She said, "Well, I need some money, and you're going to be my bank machine." So progressively, they went to various banks that she had cards in. He coerced her, intimidated her into giving him the codes. They got enough money. All the way along, she keeps saying, "You know, it's a terrible thing to be a drug addict," which he had by then confessed that he was. "We're going to get money because I'm a drug addict and I need more money." She said, "You know, Jesse, this is a terrible thing. Do you realize it's really bad to be a drug addict? That this can actually ruin a person's life. This is terrible that you're a drug addict." He said, "Yeah, I've noticed." So more money, another stop. "You really need a good drug rehab program. You really need help." "Oh, I know about drug rehab programs. None of them have worked for me." Another machine. She says, "But what you really need is Jesus." He goes, "I'll be right back." He gets some more money. He's about to leave her by the side of the road. And she says, "You know, I can't even get out of the car." So Jesse comes around to the passenger side and opens the door and helps Doris get out of the car and then escorts her around the front of the car toward the driver's side. And he then helps her into the car and lifts up her legs and puts the seatbelt across her and buckles it and then gives her a kiss on her left cheek. She said, "You know what, Jesse? I'm going to ask that you get arrested. I'm going to pray that God will find you. Have you done this to other people? Like, this is a really bad idea. Do you normally do this on Sundays? Or how does this work for you? I'm going to pray that you get caught. And then I'm going to go and say to the judge, you really need to be in jail because you've got to stop this. But you also really need a good drug rehab program. And I've heard that you haven't been in one, but there are good ones. And third, I want to make sure that you know about Jesus, but that's my responsibility." So it was not a surprise. Within the week, I get a call from Doris, a lineup. She'd been called in. Jesse, third from the left. There it was. Okay, got it. There's Jesse. So eventually I go with Doris to the moment when she's going to sit in the witness box and testify about what happened. So I'm sitting there, and she gets into the witness box. And she more or less just kind of gives a little wave over to Jesse and says, "You know, hey, Jesse, it's me, Doris. Remember, we had that time in the car." "And I just want to say that, Judge, I told Jesse that I was going to pray that this very moment would be happening. So first, Judge, you're an answer to prayer. Secondly, you really need to find him guilty because it's everything that is in this, that exactly. He did that to me and to other people who were also lined up. Secondly, he apparently has been given drug rehab programs in the past, but they haven't worked. So he needs a really good drug rehab program. Please don't give him a bad one. That's not going to help him or anyone else, including people like me. And thirdly, he needs Jesus. I know that's not your business, but it's mine." He, of course, is convicted and Doris starts the process of going every week to a nearby jail where she could call on Jesse. And she just showed up as a friend. She talked to him about his life. She talked to him about why and how he had become a drug addict. She talked to him about the pain that he was carrying. She talked to him about his family. And most of all, she talked to him about Jesus and how much he was seen in a way that no one else saw him and had the capacity to do something in him that could actually transform him. And in light of that, she longed for him to become a disciple. This went on for weeks, which turned into months, and eventually after, I think it was something like 6 or 8 months, he was moved to a much more distant jail, and Doris wasn't able to continue. We have no idea what Jesse's story is, but God does. And in the context of that story, it was a vivid reminder to me through Doris that sometimes years ago when people would wear "What Would Jesus Do" bracelets, I remember thinking as I sat in Doris's apartment, what would Doris do? If I could just do what Doris did, I would be more like the Jesus that I want to represent. I beg you, my brothers and sisters, in this moment in American church history, when the church is in pain and writhing and showing itself to be so immature and underdeveloped and under-transformed and perceiving one another simply through the sociological, economic, racial, and political lenses of our day, in that moment, what is God's intention? To make a church of people who have presented their whole selves to God, not just for a liturgical moment, but for a life of worship, which looks radically different because it is being transformed by the renewing of our whole perception, that we might prove, Paul goes on to say, what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. If you walk through the rest of chapter 12, which we don't have time to do, it's filled with this amazing language, gritty, gritty language. What is it going to take to love like Jesus loved? What is it going to take to care and to not give in? What is it going to take to be light and salt in the world? What is it going to take to be faithful yeast in the world? It's about being transformed. And that is the very work that God wants to do. I believe he's doing it in you. I believe he's doing it in me. It's a long work. It's a deep work. But it has to be a work that is authentic and real and grounded in the reality of what life actually is. Not only in a liturgical space, but in the hardest and most difficult places of our lives. Inward places, outward places, public places, professional places, social places, familial places, in whatever setting. Those are the places where, in Paul's language elsewhere, we work out our own salvation. This is the place where all of that is gathered up. Therefore, I beg you, University Presbyterian Church in Seattle in 2023, I beg you to present your whole bodies as living sacrifices, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. But friends, be warned. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Lord, this uncomfortable text, this daunting vision, this depth of transformation is often not what we've even sought. Just a little dab is often all we pursue. Oh God, in your mercy, transform this church ever more deeply, knowing its legacy, feeling nothing but gratitude with the impact of UPC on me. May it in this season be a fresh impact by these people and those in the first service and those online and those in whatever settings and over whatever period of time. May they know the reality of your love and mercy to make us and all things new. For it is in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Dr. Labberton. So much to meditate on there. Please, if you're willing and able, stand and sing with us as we respond. How great is our God?
Thank you again for joining us. Yeah, we can give God all the glory. We can give those that were up here helping us into a time of worship. Dr. Labberton, thank you for being sensitive to the Spirit this morning. I felt like in the second service here was almost a different sermon from the first sermon. And perhaps it was because there were those here that needed to hear exactly what was preached in this specific sermon at this time. So thank you for your sensitivity to God's calling. And as we wrap up this portion of worship, may I remind you that being together in community is also a form of worship. And so I invite you to join us upstairs in a time of coffee and cocoa and tea to just be with one another. For those of you that are college-aged and or young adults, we have, again, we have our breakfast at the Palmer House across the street. Would love to see you there as we engage in worship through the context of community. And if God spoke to you in some kind of way this morning, and you said yes to Jesus for the first time, you said yes to Jesus for the 100th time, we want to know, we want to walk alongside you in your journey of faith. So please, you can do this even online at upc.org/Jesus. You can fill out a connect card just saying you want to connect with somebody and put it in the silver box in the lobby. Or you can pray with someone right now. I'm going to invite the prayer team up forward. And let me just say this. If you need or want prayer, please do not leave here without being prayed over. And there will be prayer partners up here to pray over you. And just a few dates to keep in mind. On November 14th at 7 p.m., we will have an author give a talk about her experience from Oregon and her experience with the Exclusion Act and as a white woman, how she wanted to respond to racism. Her name is Sarah Sanderson, November 14th at 7 p.m. upstairs in Geneva. On the 22nd of November at 7 p.m., we will have our Thanksgiving Eve service. So please join us then. Dr. Labberton can give us our benediction.
In a moment when AI is redefining what mindfulness means and informing us about what and what not to perceive, in a world that is fractured and broken and at war in so many deep and profound ways, whether military or psychological or emotional, whether familial or ecclesial, we need the good news. And Paul has given us that this morning. May we receive it. I don't feel I can really leave this space without quoting C.S. Lewis. He says in The Weight of Glory, "Our Lord finds our desires not too strong, but too weak. We're like children who would rather go on making mud pies in the slum because we cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at the sea. We are far too easily pleased." That will not be true if we live Romans 12, 1 and 2, and allow the reality of that good news to permeate our whole being, enlarging our imaginations, increasing our love, engaging our lives in the reality that God has given his life for. May we do so in imitation of him. That God, who is able to do exceedingly abundantly, beyond all we could ask or even imagine, according to the power that is at work within us, to God be glory in the church, in this church, and in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. And God's people said,
Well, thank you for worshiping with us at University Presbyterian Church. It is such a joy to be with you online and to know you're a part of this church family as God calls us to go next door and to love our neighbors. This week, remember, as Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, God is making his appeal through us. Isn't that amazing? Well, listen, take care, have a great week, and we look forward to being with you again next week.